energy. Rainbow Serpent. Swept through the forest. Creating life in water and rivers. Way out into the sea. Restless in the double island. Soft on the breeze.
So today's lecture will be a follow-up to last week's Thinking Like a Painter. And I'll be doing a demonstration painting in Photoshop, which I kind of recorded with a screen recorder. And we can kind of watch my process and we can talk about some of the fundamentals we talked about last week and how they kind of affect or how they're used in painting. Just here, the first slide I've got up is just a collection of images which I use for reference for this painting. So before I kind of got into it, I kind of thought of paintings I liked or photographers I liked. We just got a few up here. So in the top left image was like the main one that kind of triggered the painting. And that was a photograph by an anthropologist called Wade Davis, of an Australian Aboriginal. And then we've got below that NC Wyeth, got Sydney Long next to that, got a picture of a black opal, we've got an American painter, a few paintings by Eric Bowman, which is a colourist that I really like. And then a picture, a screenshot from the new Uncharted 4 game. I like some of the hair lighting on that. And a photographer called Benotti, I think he's French, that picture there in the nighttime, the two girls I liked. And the top painting there with the guy with the red shirt is by Sergei Koloski. I think, I'm not sure where he's from, Polish maybe, Polish painter. Digital painter. And so this is just kind of a collection of images which you'll kind of see how they influenced my painting as I work, but I'll talk about them later, so I thought I'd put them up first. So here we are in Photoshop. So this painting was done over, I think it was maybe 4, 5, 6 hours. It was kind of two sittings, and you can kind of see here's just early days where I'm kind of just looking like kind of searching around for the composition. And if we kind of refer back to last week, it's kind of the defining the shapes and kind of working out where stuff will sit in the painting. And I'm kind of constantly at this stage jumping to the internet and just doing random brush strokes to kind of see what the brush strokes kind of how they inspire me and how that they kind of I can kind of learn from the kind of chaos. And I kind of had the idea that I wanted this rainbow serpent kind of like slithering through the valley, kind of inspired by that audio track which you kind of heard at the start. And I wanted it to be like a moonlit scene, so I'm up there kind of putting the moon in and clouds. And I'd been camping last weekend, so that was kind of, I'd seen some really cool kind of Australian landscape with which kind of had some really kind of cool valleys and kind of like trees that kind of rolled over down hills. And I really liked that kind of rolling trees look. So that was kind of something I wanted to put in this painting. And obviously there's the character, which I've kind of got from that photograph by Wade Davis. So that was kind of always good to have that inspiration there to kind of drive the painting. So here I'm just working kind of in values. You can kind of see I'm kind of defining where my dark and lights are. I kind of knew the rainbow serpent, which you can kind of see down the left, was going to be kind of white, quite light. And then the figure in the foreground was going to be quite dark to kind of create that silhouette. And you've got that kind of mountain there. One thing I'll probably mention here, I suppose, is like when you're designing your shapes and stuff like that, it's always kind of the game is kind of trying to make a good feeling of depth because you want the viewer to kind of be sucked into the painting. I went a bit crazy there, lines everywhere. I think scrap that idea. So I think creating depth, a lot of the time you're trying to overlap objects so you can kind of see that I put the figure kind of behind the tree there put kind of like a bush in the foreground, and it's all about trying to create that sense of depth to feel that, like, you are in a landscape. And it creates that kind of more believability. So I'm kind of shifting around objects, kind of breaking them up into, like, you know, foreground, mid-ground, background situation, and just trying to work out how stuff sits. Kind of popped a little moon in there, which is kind of inspired by the moon, but also those Eric Bowman paintings that I really like. So he's the kind of serpent, and I'm kind of adding some more value here, working out the darks to try to really work out the kind of the composition in terms of big light shapes and big dark shapes. And there's kind of the valleys, which were kind of inspired by the weekend and the audio track at the start. I just flipped the painting here because it's kind of a common trick to kind of like check your composition or check your layout of shapes, because I think your eye gets a bit kind of comfortable, but like switching it kind of makes you rethink ideas. So here I actually made a big change and I put the figure further up in the top corner. I think this was kind of me just trying to break the kind of similar compositions I always throw down, because I've got kind of like a tendency to like, yeah, use the same composition over and over again, but I kind of broke it, I think. And here I've pulled in a reference image. So it's kind of false that painters don't use any reference. If you hear any painters say they don't use reference, they're probably talking crap. It's all the time I pull up, go to the internet, and I'll look for ideas and stuff like that for my paintings and just to work out shapes. So I've kind of popped the serpent down there. And so as we talked about last week, it's kind of like when you're doing kind of composition and stuff like that, you stay in tones and in just black and white, and you kind of don't use colour, because it's a lot easier to think about your painting as shapes of black and white and mid-tones. And then later on, you can kind of bring the colour back in to kind of once you've really kind of worked out your composition. So I think at this stage, this is probably the end of, I think, one sitting, and I kind of shut it down, went to bed. And I was kind of happy with the composition. Then I woke up in the morning, and it's nice to have a break. But I came in here with the colour, so there's this colour happening. So I always start with like a warm underpainting, like a warm, bright underpainting. Well, actually, not always, but it's nice on a lot of scenes to have a really complementary underpainting. So say like if you've got like a very blue painting, you have like a very like warm orangey underpainting, and you can kind of saturate that. The idea is that I use kind of Photoshop brushes that are kind of like broken, so they're not solid shapes, and the idea is that then if I put a blue over the top of the warm, it kind of creates like a vibration of color, and colors become more intense and kind of feels like they're glowing a lot more than just a solid blue. It's kind of like, I think, from, you know, you probably see it in a lot of kind of, I think it's pointillism, and it's like that kind of vibrating color. Or like Monet did it all the time, the impressionists, in terms of like putting opposite colors next to each other to intensify color. So it's kind of the idea of the underpainting and these broken kind of colors in here. So yeah, I try to I use Command and click on a layer to kind of select all the pixels of that layer, and so that way I can kind of retain my brush marks I've got on the layer. It's a nice way of kind of, for example, the tree there, I kind of just mask off the layer and then paint on top of it. It's a kind of a cool way of keeping the nice shapes you've made in Photoshop with your brushes, and not just kind of repainting everything. And a lot of people you'll probably hear for paintings and stuff in Photoshop, they say, oh, you can do a bit of a colour layer on top. But I tend to not use that. I feel like my painting's like a colour layers on top of like a black and white layer. But I feel like that tends to lead to quite muddy paintings. So I'd avoid doing that, and I'd just select the layer and actually pick my colour and then paint that on top. So here I kind of used a brush, and then I put like a... adjusted the hue jitter on my brush, so it kind of gave me that cool rainbow effect. There's a lot of cool brush settings you can play with to kind of create stuff. So I play with the serpent for a while here. Just kind of trying to get the snake looking right. But I do change my approach to that. I make it a lot bigger there. And I suppose the reason for that was I felt like it didn't feel as kind of big and epic and almost kind of like ghostly, like it was flowing through the landscape. And I think that there was also like a snake with an eye down there, and it was kind of taking focus away from the character, and they were kind of competing for interest by the viewer, I suppose. And I just didn't want the second eye in there because I think it just seemed like there was too much. So I would have either had to pick one or the other. So I kind of simplified it. And I think there's also something cool about the, you know, in kind of horror films and stuff where they don't show you the character. Like the character's kind of hidden. And it's kind of like kind of makes it even more kind of, I don't know, supernatural or kind of mystical that you can't actually see it. So I thought it was cool. This is cool. So I saw this is Uncharted 4. It's like a game that you guys have probably all heard about, just come out, depending on when you're watching this video. But I'm kind of referencing the character's hair because they had this really nice effect of the rim light happening. So I thought I could do that with the moon. So there I am just kind of playing with some little brushes to kind of create that idea that the moon's kind of breaking through the character's hair. And then I used the smudge tool there to kind of soften the edge. You'll see me using the smudge tool a lot, and that's kind of a common thing in Photoshop to use a smudge tool to kind of like, you know, soften edges. You know how we were talking about edges in the previous lecture? And edges are just kind of the transition of shapes. And I did a perspective transform them on the rainbow serpent to make him feel like he was kind of going deeper into the painting. So he's kind of like he was flowing over the landscape. I used selection tool again. Got some leaves kind of like smashing up, almost like the serpent was kind of like forming the landscape, which is how it goes in the story. Get some stars in the top. It's pretty cool. And these are meant to be kind of gum trees, so I kind of try to look at kind of gum trees in real life all the time to try to reference them and make them kind of feel like that. And here I'm just using the smudge tool on my rainbow serpent to see how I can kind of create stuff. But you can see a lot of the time I kind of create layers and I'll try out an effect and I'll just see how it works and I either like kind of kill it or start it again. And sometimes I'll make several like new attempts. So I kind of smudge the trees here a little bit like a Van Gogh painting because I want to create that kind of mystical feeling to the painting. Put some gradients in on the sides there, mainly to control the viewer's eye. I think it's pretty important that we kind of focused it on the character and the moon. It's almost like characters looking out and having this kind of like spiritual experience where he's seeing this serpent flow through the landscape. I kind of wanted you to focus in there and just kind of think a bit about what was happening there and then kind of trap your eye to travel down to the serpent, see what he's playing. But you can kind of see a lot of the, and added some color then into the moon, which was cool. You can kind of see a lot of time not a lot's changed from that early composition I threw down, and that's to kind of just to show you that like once you get your composition, it's really important. And if you get a cool composition and the composition's nice, that's usually half the battle. And then you can come in and worry about color and stuff and start really making that color sing, which you can kind of see here. So I think that's pretty much the end of the recording, and that's the finished painting up there. Hope you enjoyed watching. It was kind of enjoyable and interesting for me because I'd never recorded myself paint, so it's nice to see how I think and kind of probably could learn a little bit from it. And I hope you guys learned from it. If you've got any questions about some techniques I used in there or anything you saw that you were kind of curious about, you can ask me in class, and I hope you enjoyed it, and thanks very much for watching.